Why do I live in this male adult body? I'm so boring compared to Little Red. You know, I want to be in Little Red's head all day long. So when you ask me how much I love children, when I can.
Shoot the shit with people we genuinely think kick ass. And I have exciting news today. We are going, I was gonna say international, but really he's Canadian, but he's dually. So we're talking to Kirk Muspratt today, who is quarantined in our hometown right now. He's stuck here. He can't go back to Chicago where he works and does all of his music. So we're taking full advantage of that on this episode. And although we're still Zooming, I guess we could have done it either way. So we've got Kirk Muspratt here today with us. Hey, Kirk, how you doing?
Hi, I'm doing great. It's lovely to see you both.
Yeah, you too. I'm going to just tell people a little bit about you, Kirk, before we jump into our conversations, just to provide a little bit of context of who you are and why we wanted to pick your brain and open up conversation with you. So before we do these podcasts, I always ask people, can you just send us like people who are professional, you know, like Kirk, he's got this huge profession. Can you send me your bio so I could do a write-up of an introduction? So I got his bio and it's like 3 pages long and I needed a music dictionary to understand a lot of it and like an atlas to look up all of the places that he studied and conducted. And so I condensed it all down to a short paragraph for those of us out there who aren't living entirely in the music world. But really, this is how I introduce you today, Kirk, is really how I see you personally. So just to provide the professional context, Kirk is the conductor of the Northwest Indiana Symphony, as well as the Chicago New Philharmonic Opera and the Chicago New Philharmonic Orchestra. Did I get that right? Yes. Okay. And I do have notes because I don't want to miss anything. Kirk has studied around the world and conducted around the world. I always think it's really cool. He studied at Juilliard, which Lady Gaga. I like that similarity that you guys have. Maybe you guys will study to same teachers. I don't know. received the 2018 Conductor of the Year Award. Was named Chicagoan, is that how you say it? Chicagoan of the Year in classical music. But most importantly, that's it. That's your career. Most importantly, Kirk Muspratt comes from the Crow's Nest Pass, Alberta, Canada. In the Crow's Nest Pass, Kirk Muspratt has adjudicated at four of our music festivals. He has spoken as the keynote speaker at our graduations twice, mine and my sister's, coincidentally. He knows pretty much every family and their history, every child's name and their grandparents and their great-grandparents. And in fact, right before we started recording, he goes to Jody, he says, "You're a Bastin hoot." And then he told her family history. And he said, "And that aunt," and he's more than I know about Jody, so that's important about Kirk. He remembers the name of every child he meets, and he was telling Jody about her nieces, Sophia, just shout out. What else do I have on here that's really important to me about you? You recently repurchased your childhood home. You lived in this home, and then it was owned by somebody else, and then you repurchased it, and this is where you get away from the big city life. You come back to the mountains. One of my all-time favorite memories of you, Kirk, is when I was like just a wee lass and you came to our house. It was probably one of the first times that I've met you, although you knew me. And here we're having this conversation, and Kirk treats kids like they're I don't know, he makes you feel like there's magic in the air, kind of. And I remember that night to be very magical. And he pulls out of his suitcase this sweater of the big snit, and felt like it was his sweater. He wore it all the time, but he gave it to me. I think I was like 6, maybe 7, maybe, I don't know, between 6 and 10-ish. And then he spent that time. I remember later in that week, maybe I shouldn't say this, but I shouldn't say this for everyone here, but plunked my sister on his lap in Elvis, his Jeep, and let my sister have practice drive. Like, she was like 3, maybe. So, like, just this amazing relationship. Was it my grandma was your teacher? Was your teacher. And then one of my favorite things is a secret that maybe not everybody in the world knows, but Kirk has a special watch. And on the inside of his watch, oh no, he's not wearing it. On the inside of his watch says, Caraggio, you are from the CNP. That goes to show you how deeply he is rooted to our hometown here. So while he's going to get it, I wonder if we can see the actual, like, the engraving. I wonder if it'll show up clear on the... you can kind of see it around there.
And see the crow's nest. Yeah.
I love that.
So, Kirk, you are an international presence, especially in the world of music. But to us who live here in the Crow's Nest Pass, you're kind of like family. And so it's a really cool dynamic. And we're really excited to get to dive into your music, like who you are as a musician, but also who you are as a family member, as one of the familia of the Crow's Nest Pass, and what you have to offer the people who are watching from both perspectives. So thanks so much for being here with us tonight.
Oh, it's indeed my pleasure to be with both of you.
Nice.
It's pretty exciting. And Courtney knows you a lot better than I do, although I was a teacher in the room when you were the keynote speaker for Char's graduation, because I taught Char, one of my definitely most memorable favorite students ever. And I love the story about you letting her drive the car, because we were, before we started recording, we were talking about my Uncle Peter, who you know, and that was what he did with all of us. That was like the thing that he did with all the nieces and nephews. He would take us down the old Frank Road and let us drive. And it was,
I think that's where we were too.
And all the moms were like, you know, none of the moms were for it, but it was like, you couldn't wait to hit the age where Uncle Peter would take you driving. We were usually about 9 or 10, I think, when he would take us. So that's creating fond memories for children, for sure. So to help everyone get to know you a little bit better, we're just going to throw some rapid fire questions at you, Kirk. That's kind of our thing. We start off with some rapid fire questions that are fun. And then we'll get into the nitty gritty of the conversation. So, Kirk, favorite color?
Black.
Favorite smell?
Oh, lilacs, especially here right now.
They are lilacs, beautiful.
Right? Lavender right now. I go and the carragana bushes when I'm taking my walk. Oh, it's just, and I've loved them since I was a little kid because they were all over this block. People had lilac, especially lilac bushes. Yeah.
Yeah, that is awesome. And your favorite place in your home?
My favorite place in my home is probably down in the furnace room, because it's still the old dirt concrete room with the, and it smells, every time I come in the house, I smell coal. You cannot get the coal out of this house. And it's still like, it goes right into the hill, and the coal bin is still there. And, you know, I've tried to change it, but it's, I smell coal every time I come, and I love the smell of coal. I adore it. When I walk along the railroad tracks, you know, because there's coal, of course, all along the railroad tracks, that is a smell. It just makes me, it probably just takes me back to when I was a little boy, you know?
Yeah, for sure. I know that smell. When I run out past River Bottom along the river, you get to a certain place where that's kind of all you can smell is the coal.
Right.
Yeah.
The same thing, I go up Hipples in the different places, like in Coleman or behind the hospital in Blairmore. I know I'm not supposed to walk there, but I was, and it's all still coal. Everything's coal. I mean, when you're up past the golf course, it's all coal.
Yeah.
You know, when you go up Willow Drive, it's all coal. You know, it's coal mining capital of Canada. So,
only problem with coal is that your white dog, like my white dog, is never white. Well, she's white on the top half and then on the bottom half, black when we go up for runs.
And by the way, your in-law's dog is the same. I saw him walking by today, and he looked like he was fishing for turtles somewhere in a mud field.
Yeah. Doesn't take much.
Okay, Kirk, what's your favorite sound?
My favorite sound, and I'm sure this is a cliche because many people love this, is a little kid laughing or greeting me. Like Courtney's niece the other day, Mackenzie, she's only about a year and a half or something.
Three, close.
She's three, okay. But she saw me for the second time, and she just says, hi, how are you? With these little pink cheeks. And then she starts laughing, you know? And so when the kids are little, I usually have some kind of tickle fest with them and they're scared of me. But when they start laughing, I'm sure that's for all of us. We love the smell of cut grass. We love the smell of wood burning. You know, we love the smell of a little baby's tummy button, you know. But a kid laughing, that's it.
Nothing like it, that's for sure.
Yeah, for sure. Awesome. Thank you for sharing all those little bits and pieces of you. Maybe let's dive now into the music side of you, because music is your life. Music is what you do for work. Music is what you do as a passion. Can you just share with our audience just a little bit more about what you actually do?
Yeah, like interpret the 3-page bio that you have and the 16-page resume. What does that actually mean?
Mostly what I do is I sit on my ASS and I study scores. So there's an opening page of a Beethoven symphony and I look at that page and I hear it in my head and I think about what I have to do to conduct it well. What are the problems going to be? How the musicians need help in a certain way, what's going to go wrong, what I want, what my interpretation is. And so it's like, maybe it's like being an actor or a stage director where you get a script or a book and then you read it. And if you're Meryl Streep or Laurence Olivier or whoever, then you have to know that script inside out and understand that this is Midsummer Night Dream of Shakespeare or, you know, of whoever it is. And, you know, with this music, and you have to understand it inside out. And then you have to understand as the stage director, how you want Laurence Olivier to enter that room, how you want Meryl Streep to react to so-and-so, where you want to, you know, all of that stuff. So it's a very creative thing, but I have a term for it. It's called ass time. I'm sorry to be so crude, but if you don't spend time sitting and studying that score in detail by yourself for long periods of time, and you need chunks of time. You cannot spend 3 minutes and 7 minutes and 12 minutes. You need to sit for 3 hours and not get up, and then maybe you have some idea about just maybe the A theme or something of a symphony the first time through. You know, that's what I spend most of my time doing. The rest of the time, I would say, is spent communicating with people, whether they're patrons who have a question, a complaint, a suggestion, an idea, an admonition, a little bit of praise, and getting back to them, understanding them very well, hopefully, and creating parts of the concert so that you both will want to come back to the concert. It's not just that the musicians are great or we performed well, but what are the surrounding things in the concert, around the concert, that I can help create with my colleagues to make it really an experience. Mm-hmm. Well, I spend most of my time alone. I love it. I get to use my imagination. You can't have any friends. You can't have any cats. You can't have any plants. But that's okay. It's like a lot of things that you're devoted to. You know, when you, Courtney, when you had your baby, you know, you have one baby, right? You know, like she's three now about. But of course, when you have something that needs that kind of focus and attention, your whole life is upside down. And it's sort of like that with a score. It's not a human being, but Beethoven is expecting me to know what I'm doing. The musicians are expecting me to know what I'm doing. The audience is expecting me to know what I'm doing. So
I haven't had the chance to see, like, I've only actually been to one, just when you were conducting in Calgary for the ballet there. I got to go to the ballet when I was maybe 10, 12 years old, I think I was. And very fond memory for me because you took me backstage and I got to meet the dancers. And then it was the very first time that I think I was ever allowed to stay out past midnight with my mom, actually knowing because we were there. You took us out with one of the male ballerinas, you call a male a ballerina? Yeah.
Male dancers.
Male dancer. Okay. One of the male dancers. And we were at this, I don't even remember this place. I was too young to know where I was exactly, but stayed out super late. And then you told me that guy actually got fired after. Like, it was just this like crazy world that I'd never seen before that night. But one thing that I clearly you got me like connected to more than just this show. And although I haven't had the chance to be in Chicago and see any of the shows there, it's very clear, like when you look up Kirk Muspratt on the internet and it takes you to your webpage, and when you're listening to other things, you know, like on YouTube about you or clips from other things and reading newspaper articles and stuff like that, how you make it your mission to really pull the audience in and engage the audience in a way that's very unique. And get them involved almost like at Kirk's, what do you call it? Kirk's cookies. And you get the kids.
Cookies with Kirk, yeah.
Cookies with Kirk, right? Yeah, cookies with Kirk. Like, what exactly is that? What do you do with that?
So what happens after the concerts are that there are cookies, or sometimes there's strawberries or champagne, depending on the orchestra, depending on the concert, those kinds of things. And they're beautifully laid out. And so the patrons go into the lobby. And then I go out and I plant myself right by the steps, and the cookies are down there, right? And they're homemade cookies. They're really, really, really good cookies. And so it's just a way for people to mix, to talk, to have some social part of the evening together, to make new friends, to see other friends that have been there, to talk to the musicians, to talk to the soloists. Like right after when we do an opera, usually what happens in an opera is everybody goes back in their costumes to the costume, wig, makeup people, and all the cleaning people who have to do everything. And they take off their costumes, they change, they get their normal clothes on, and then they come out to see their parents or their boyfriend or something. I have them come right off the stage out into the lobby. So you get to see the Duke or the prisoner or the bad commandant or the princess, or, you know, and they're all in their costumes and they talk to people. You know, I think I think that music is about people, because so Bach is born in 1685 and he writes music basically for the church. Okay. Beethoven is writing music in 1805 about revolution in the world. And there is revolution everywhere. And by the way, right at that time of the Fifth Symphony or Third Symphony, Napoleon rolls through, you know, taking over Europe. And then you get a guy like Rachmaninoff, who is escaping Russia right before the revolution in 1917. Then you have Mick Jagger writing music in the 1960s about revolution. And yet, you know what? You like the Rolling Stones, and you love Rachmaninoff, and Bach is the greatest, and Beethoven is the greatest of the greatest. So what else is there in the world? Because you two are not going to wear hoop skirts. You two are not going to accept that you can't vote. You two are not going to accept that you couldn't be the prime minister. Right. You know, you two are not going to accept that your children don't have enough to eat. The world changes, but something like music, hits people, whether it's a piece that Bach wrote in 1735 or Beethoven wrote in 1810 or Rachmaninoff wrote in 1922 or Mick Jagger wrote in 1966 or your favorite Jody, Lady Gaga, is singing, you know, today. It hits us. And it's spiritual, it's eternal, it teaches us about each other, it connects us as human beings. You go to hear the Nutcracker.
That's like Michaela. Her favorite movie, one of her all-time favorite. Well, she's got a couple. Frozen is definitely one of them. But her other favorites, Mary Poppins and Somewhere Over the Rainbow. That has a movie.
Yeah.
What is the name of that movie, you guys? Thank you, Wizard of Oz. But I'm like, that's over 100 years old, right? And this little girl who's 3 years old is like in love with this movie, because of the story, but because of the music too, right? And the music is so iconic, and The Sound of Music. She loves that movie, and she sings the songs like it's the music, and she doesn't know what's going on. Like, she doesn't get the political background to it, and you know, towards the end, she's like, "Mom, why are they hiding?" You know, like. She asks me, Kurt, I'm not kidding. So there was a phase of her life for like 3 months where she listened to, you know, the scene on the stairs where they're singing So Long Farewell. She right. knew every single word, and she would watch it and sing it and watch it and sing it and watch it and sing it. And then she moved into, she kind of progressed through all the different songs. She likes them all. But it was really interesting. Like it didn't... You know, it was very out of character for this little, like, 2-year-old at the time to be...
But see, that's the... He doesn't know whether it's Lady Gaga.
Right.
Or whether it's Palestrina, or whether it's Scarlatti, or whether it's Puccini, or it is Rodgers and Hammerstein, who are right. unbelievable in their own right. But here's a little kid who doesn't know anything about treble clef, bass clef, saxophone, choirs, counterpoint, guitar... Nothing. And what is she? And it gets to her.
Yeah, you know, it's just a feeling.
It just gets to her. Yeah. And so at some point, Courtney, will I be able to tell Jody the worm story about her singing, about Little Red singing the lullaby?
Oh, yeah. Let's save it. We really want to dive into the whole kid conversation later, for sure.
Yeah, it started with her singing a lullaby behind me on the step. And I heard her singing. And so... It goes back to music. Okay, I'll do what you guys want me to do. It's okay.
Yeah.
I love this. It's funny to me because kids, like music, there's no right or wrong for them for music. And they just make sound, and whatever sound they make, they love. And they don't think about judgment. And as soon as you hit a certain age, you know, singing becomes like a fear, I think, for a lot of adults, right? To sing in front of somebody else, right? Like, if somebody asked me to sing right now, I probably wouldn't want to. But when they're little, like, I have so many videos of my kids when they were little, you know, just grabbing the guitar and grabbing some like thing to pretend to be a microphone and just singing their hearts out. You can't even really understand their words because they're so little, and they just, it's just in them. Mm-hmm. And then at some point for us, I think the outside world gets in our head, and it's not
Of course,
you know.
Well, music is like, you know, you'll see the things on YouTube or something of some little baby who's just barely able to sit up, and somebody will say a certain word like monkey doodle, and they just start roaring laughing, and you think, you know what, 11 months ago that little boy or girl was inside his mommy's tummy. So it's not that he has a sense of humor, it's that the thing of humor is in human beings. Yeah. And it's the thing of music. Courtney, when you go up to your in-laws around the corner where Canaris used to live on the corner, 3 houses from here, I think I've told you this story that my mother used to have to go downtown shopping, down the hill to the town, and she would leave me with my grandpa when my grandpa could handle me, because I was a very wild little kid. And one day, Mrs. Canaris, who used to marry Canaris, had a piano on her veranda, and she used to play all these Scottish old beautiful songs by ear on the veranda. So my mom said, "Oh, Mary, would you watch Kurt for 20 minutes? I've got to go downtown." you know, I'm just going to go get some fish or something like that. And Mrs. Kinnear just said, sure, I'll watch him. But she kept playing the piano. And when my mother came back, I hadn't moved one inch. And I was either 3 or 4 years old. And Mrs. Kinnear said, I can't believe him. He just sat there and listened to me and sat there. So then my mother kept doing that, you know. And I remember my brother playing our piano, our little piano here, and me playing with my trucks. Here, I have my trucks right here, you see? My trucks, my police car.
Awesome.
Airplanes on the rug, and the rug used to have a sort of flower pan, and I would park them and make garages for them and do stuff. And I remember my brother playing hymns on the piano. Now, I'm crawling around on the floor, and he's maybe 11 or 12. And I remember just being astonished by the whole thing. And it's, you know, he's just playing, when he cometh, or holy, holy. And I remember just being enamored by it. Absolutely enamored by it. So I think I was just smitten by music. And like your husband's a scientist, sort of, right? Or Courtney's sort of a language person. She has a gift for language. You know, me, I think it was destiny. I think I was born on this hill to be in a musical place on earth with just snow and hockey and music.
Well, it's interesting because, like, you say that this is a musical place, and
yeah.
I think even still there's this music, there's sort of a new, like a rebirthing, I think, of the music scene in our town with some of the families who are here. And then like we had Tara Dawn Hazelton on our podcast a couple of episodes back. And so this is a new musician who's moved into town. She's a jazz musician. And so there's all these different types of music. Our music festival, is it the longest music festival, I believe, in Canada? Is that right? And and it started to lose a little steam. And now I feel it's taking a turn and it's picking up steam again. And there's lots more people are just, I'm finding that it's in town anyways, it feels like what you're talking about in terms of going down to the neighbor's house and enjoying music together. I think that like community aspect of enjoying music together and creating music it's something that I am excited for Michaela to get to experience, like that we've got a fiddle group and we've got like they do the barn dance and families get together. Like, I mean, that feels so old fashioned, but it's so cool, right? Like, I mean, old fashioned if you're not from a little town like this, right? But yeah, like it's neat. It's just really cool to see how it's kind of growing and evolving but how rooted it is in our actual community. So it's not a surprise that
Court, I often think like that God, I mean, I don't want to be in any way proselytizing or something like that, but for me, these hills here are very like spiritual. Like, mm. I've God since I was a little boy and the wonder of things, and music was that. Like, I was put here not during the Depression, not during the Russian Revolution, when there's not one really working here, but when all the mines were working, when everybody spoke another language, when everybody was cooking food at home that was from their country, where I heard Puccini at the, you know, maybe the Sharas or the Giacomuzzi's house, or, you know, when I went to a wedding, there was a Czech band playing down at the, you know, after the wedding, where, you know, there was a dance every single weekend in more than one, either the Polish Hall, the Italian Hall, the Elks Hall, the Moose Hall, the Hillcrest Minor Club. And there was a group of 5 or 6 guys playing polkas and waltzes. And that was life here. That was life here. And so I was put down right here where there's just snow and hockey and coal mining and music out the wazoo, like music that really, and every kid studied music. Every single kid studied music. And we had no music in school. We did it all after school, on weekends, and it was like a boy playing hockey here. Of course you're going to play hockey. Of course you're going to ski. You know, yeah. What's your dad? He works in the mine. Okay, do you take piano lessons? Yes. You know? And now what I really like here is that the dance community in the past and the art community in the past.
It's like they're starting really, to.
Yeah. So it's a, you know, not my art form by any means, but I really like the fact that your daughter, you know, or your daughters could have the advantage of having a really good, you know, ballet and dance studio here if they want. Or if they're artistically inclined, they could like look at somebody's photography or look at somebody's oil painting or look at, take a class in something. So it's always environment. And, you know, for you two who are teachers, I think if you have the right school and the right teacher and the right principal and the right chemistry lab and the right basketball court and all of those things, that a kid has a chance. You might be Michael Jordan, who's going to play for the Bulls one day, but if you don't have a hoop and a basketball.
Yeah, it's something that as a mom, I'm super grateful for the decision my husband and I made to come back here and have our children here, because my girls have, they've been exposed to so much. So my oldest daughter is really quite shy and has a lot of anxiety and a lot of worries. And that was really, really apparent. Like before she could talk, we knew that was just part of who she was. And so we put her in voice lessons with Shelley. Shelley wasn't really doing voice lessons then, but we were like, well, can you like, she wants to sing. That's it. Like, can you just like make it work? She was five. Like who puts a five-year-old in voice lessons, right? Like it wasn't really about the voice lessons. It was about her, like what she got out of the 4 months she spent with Shelley, her confidence, to sing in front of somebody else for my daughter was huge. That was like pivotal for my daughter, Ella. Then she went into dance. She asked me for like a year and a half straight, can I go and dance? Okay. She clearly wants to do dance because she hasn't let up. So we put her into dance. She did dance for 3 years. As soon as it got to like the competition part of it, she went like the makeup in her and she was like, oh, I'm out. Like, that's not my thing. But her confidence, like she had to get on stage and she had to perform. And then she had adjudicated there or whatever. I don't know if that's the word they use in the dance world, you know, comes down and like gives them advice and admiration. And just being exposed to all of that has given both my daughters, they've both been in dance, like huge confidence boost. They've chosen not to continue dancing, but they have now chosen to be painting and they sell their prints and to make money for horseback riding lessons. And like this community has so much to offer that my kids get to dabble and they get to like discover what pulls them in and what gets them excited. And that's not always the same thing. And it kind of ebbs and flows, but I'm so grateful that they have the chance to connect with these adults who do these creative things so that spark can get passed on. And if it's a spark that my kids want to like explode into a flame, they get to choose to do that. Right. And it's just, you don't have that opportunity other places. It's too expensive in this city to have your kid try all these different things. But in this little community here, they get to go from like you said, dance, violin, piano, voice lessons, musical theater with Chantal Bowie, mountain biking with Carrie Lee, horseback riding. Like they just have so many options here that it's fantastic for our kids.
And it is that your daughter just loves horses and maybe she's going to be a great cowpoke. Maybe she'll end up being but it doesn't mean she can't play the viola and love the viola, you know? Mm-hmm. Or said something about your husband, how he's really a science guy, but he's like this too. And if you give a child all of that, each of us will, you know, if God gives us something to give the world, maybe we're a writer, maybe we're a great hockey player. You know, we've had great hockey players come from here, from this little town. And I think it's really, especially important for women, because women can be anything now. And that's only been the case in about the last, 50 years? Like a German president? What? you know, or, you know, those kinds of things. So why can't you be a lady conductor? Well, because for 250 years, there was never any lady conductors, you know, but so we need all of those things to give our kids. And also they make wonderful friends. So your daughters, like Courtney has a niece. No, she's your cousin. I'm sorry. You get that family. Very complicated.
In more ways than one, let me tell you.
But Bronwyn, who is now 11 or something like that, she's studying dance and gymnastics and this. And she's made this where her brothers are studying piano. And so, or like little Zofia, your niece, she has a friend named Maddie, and they have violin sleepovers. Now, you know, so Maddie and Zofia live in different towns, and they might not even be in the same grade or something, but they have that connection to the violin, and they have sleepovers, and as young women, they sort of grow up, you know, doing that. And it defines them, like, I'm a horseback riding girl, I love to go mountain biking, because I see Zofia on her mountain bike all the time, and I'm really interested in French, but I play the clarinet. So that's who I am, you know? Mm. And, you know, right away, I knew in grade one even that I was a musician and people paid attention to me. I hate to say that, you know, with my small ego, that they paid attention to me as a little boy because I played the piano well and I got trophies and I got to go to Lethbridge and I won certificates. And then people, blah, blah, blah. And my name was in the paper. And, you know, I was pretty shallow, I have to tell you. That's probably why I did it, you know. And there was lots of good food after the festival, like donuts, crispy squares, and, you know, stuff like that. So
that's probably why you do your cookies with Kirk. It's just to take you back, eh? You're like, wait, we need some pastries after this.
Sure. Well, everything's social. If you don't, you know, if you're in a dance group like your Aunt Chrissy or something like that, you know, she isn't just taking Bronwyn to dance, but she's working with all the moms and the dads to organize things, to help with costumes, to do fundraisers, to rent the hall, to do this. And so there's another community of people. Again, it comes back to people. It comes back to people.
So I'm going to, like, we have sort of this rough outline of things that we'd love to talk about. And I want to just kind of jump. We've been talking about kids. So let's keep talking about that. And it's kind of interesting. Like I made reference to your 16-page resume, but what the most interesting part to me was right at the bottom where it says your interests, and it said kids, education, or kids and teaching, one of the two. And so you have this passion for kids. Like where does that come from? Because you don't have kids. So what is it about kids that makes you come alive so much?
I like all of us, I love music. I'm smitten by music. I love nature. I love, of course, all do. We were just talking before we came on air about the mother deer that's been walking around my back alley and sleeping in my yard. And she just had her fawn. And I saw the fawn last night in the alley with the mom. And I was just like beyond wugga bugga bugga. And then I kept telling people, there's a fawn with the mother deer. And then you came on and you said, I just saw the fawn, you know? So of course I love nature and animals, but children are just the best. I'm jealous of both of you. I know jealousy is a green, evil thing that we hold in our hearts. But my real job is I should have been a kindergarten teacher. Because when you're around a great kindergarten teacher, those little kids are just the heaven and the earth. And probably grade one, two. I don't know about grade two or three. Maybe not by then, I'm not sure. But little children or infants, like Little Red. So can I tell my Little Red story
now?
Yeah.
Do that.
Okay. So Jody and everybody. I was at Courtney's mom's house the other day because she let me use her printer. And I was upstairs for a minute. And then I asked Pam, do you think we could take Little Red? That's Courtney's daughter. I call her Little Red. I call her Little Red, okay? And I said, maybe we could take her for an ice cream cone if it's okay for her mother, right? Widow went for the mother. So I'm sitting there and I hear clunk, 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 clunk on the steps. And I hear, and it's Little Red singing in the other room. And I say, Little Red, what are you singing? And she goes, I'm singing a lullaby. And I go, oh, are you going to have a little nap? She goes, no, I want to calm my worm down. And I said, you have a little worm you need to calm down? What's wrong? And she comes in and with her little hand, she opens her little hand and she hands me her worm, right? And I said, oh, what a nice worm. She goes, yeah, but I have to take them back to garden now. And I said, oh, that's really good. She goes, but I have to sing to him to calm him down before I put him back in the garden. And I'm like, wow. So she goes, and I said, yeah, you know what? That's great, Little Red, because I'm sure the family is waiting to have dinner and dessert after with them, and they're waiting for him. You know, and she goes, no, it's not a daddy worm. It's a mommy worm. Right? So anyway, I'm sitting there getting my stuff on the computer. All of a sudden, clunk, 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 clunk. And she goes, Kirk, Kirk, I found the family. And she comes over to me with the, she has her little hand, and she opens it up, and she puts the worms in my hand. She's got like 5 worms. And so I'm going, oh, Little Red, look at the little worms, you know? And she goes, yeah, that's the daddy. And she points to a special worm. Because now I get to see what the daddy looks like, not the mommy, right? And then I said, I pull it out very carefully. And then there's, and then she goes, that's the mummy. And I said, oh, yeah, I remember her, right? And I said, who's that? And she goes, that's the sister. She said, sister, like that. She goes, Thomas, that's the sister, right? You know? Okay, and then that's the brother? And she goes, yeah. And I said, oh, but there was a little worm. And it was a little worm. It's like a fairy tale. There was a skinny little worm. And she goes, that's the baby brother, right? And I said, oh, that's really nice. And I gave him, put her back in her little tiny can. And she went clunking downstairs. And it was like, what could be better than that? What could be better than that? This little 3-year-old redheaded little girl coming up to tell me about the worm family, and first of all, singing a lullaby to the mummy worm because she knows that the, you know, she has to put her back in the garden. And I'm going, why do I live in this male adult body? I'm so boring compared to Little Red. You know, I want to be in Little Red's head all day long. So when you ask me how much I love children, when I adjudicate the festival, don't tell them, but they don't have to pay me. I would do it. I would start at 6 o'clock in the morning and go till midnight. And they have to feed me, just give me a glass of water. I could do that all day long. These kids are great. I love them. I love them. That's my long-winded answer. I'm sorry.
You would, Kirk, you would love our, one of our kindergarten teachers. I think she's now the only kindergarten teacher, if I'm correct. I'm not sure with class sizes and how many kids there are. She might be the only kindergarten teacher now. But Kara Kulak was my daughter's kindergarten teacher. And when Ella went, my oldest, she was her very first year teaching here. And she started a movement at Horace Allen School, like started this brilliant movement called Wonder Walks, where they would go out once a week. They take the kindergarten class out, rain, snow, shine, whatever the weather was, and they would go for wonder walks. And it would just be like, and often they would go and they'd each find a quiet space and they would just notice things and just wonder about them. And then they'd come back and they'd talk about their wonders and what did you see? And sometimes it would be more guided, like, let's go wonder about puddles or whatever. But it's turned into this whole school thing where K-3, they do these outside wonder walks, and they're starting to do so much more with kids outside and kind of student-directed, student-led. And it just made me think of you as a kindergarten teacher, that you would probably take your students on wonder walks. And she
it takes a special gift to be that person, though. It's a certain insight, because I just talked to a group of kindergartners in Indiana. One of the teachers asked me to come and speak to them and read them a story and things like that. and I watched how skilled she was. Not only just skilled and how she knew how to be with them. She was very respectful, very caring, firm, calm, gentle. And the kids were just fine. They're only 5 years old and they were all different. You know, one was wiggly and one was very intense and one was shy and stuff. And I thought, this takes, first of all, it's a talent, like being a conductor or something. You need a talent for it. You need a love or passion for it. But you also have to have the skill sets. So she's learned the skill sets or had mentors or an education, those things that help her. And obviously, it sounds to me like she has a support system that lets her go, yes, go ahead. Because aren't they building or have they built already up at the elementary school that outdoor discovery place sort of on the side of the school? Yeah.
So I think it's kind of a progression. So every year they keep adding more to it. So they have an outside garden and they have some tables and they have some really big plans that I think kind of got put on hold because of COVID. But they had like some architects come down and design like an actual outdoor classroom shelter kind of thing. So it's kind of growing every year.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Yeah. Do you mind if I change the light? The sun's going down in the west and it's a little bit in my eyes. So I'm just going to turn my light. I beg your pardon.
Go for it.
I had to move too because I was noticing that my skin was looking really, really green. And I knew that my mom would be like, Courtney, you looked unhealthy in that. So now I have this like top light. There's actually no good spot in this room. But you make do, right?
That's right. That's
you make right. do when you're not in your own house.
Is that too dark now?
What was that, Kirk?
Is that too dark? No, it's
no,
okay.
It's fine. Yeah. Absolutely. I know that, like, it makes me actually. Oh, I wanted to tell you a story, Kirk, about because the worm story with Michaela reminded me, and this whole idea of wonder. I have this memory from when I was a teenager. I don't know how old. Exactly, but I was out for like a run or just I was out by myself and I ended up in the ball field by my house just laying on the grass first staring up at the sky kind of cloud watching and then I sort of rolled over and I was on my elbows looking in the grass and I remember seeing this ant kind of crawling around and having this moment of epiphany that holy crap, I actually don't really matter. And it was in a really positive way. And as a teenager realizing that, you know, like where the world actually like, you know, revolves around you. As a teenager realizing that it was that same thing though, is that sort of connection and this wonder. I followed this little ant and I realized like as I was watching it and it was carrying things and it was like so busy work and it gave me this really neat perspective of I was this huge thing and I was looking down at this teeny tiny little ant who was in his own like whole like separate world was happening for this creature and he was completely oblivious to me, right? And I was like, holy smokes, like that is me to the rest of the world, like the rest of the world is completely oblivious to me. And a really it was a very freeing moment where I was like, holy smokes, I don't have to pretend to be anybody. Like no one actually really cares. Like I could just be this little ant and like exist and be happy and just work, you know? And I wonder what happened there. Let's see if he can get himself back on. Yay, he did it.
Sorry, that's my phone.
That's okay.
Sorry, no. It's okay. Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, it was a really interesting moment. And when speaking of that whole concept of wonder, it really was quite profound to me. I think of it often, actually.
It's something that you and I, we all three of us get to experience here. And now that I've been here for several months, because usually I'm here for just a few weeks, I get to now be in the dirt. I get to be in the coal. I get to attack the dandelions. I get to see the bees. I get to do all that. And for me personally, that's really important. Like I live in a big city and I live in a 100-story building and I have a nice car to drive and I'm on concrete and I'm on beautiful halls and all that. But it's very, maybe it's just because I'm from here, But I wish that we could all live in a small town. I wish we all could have a garden. I mean, what I learned from your mother about dandelions, Courtney, you know, about bees, you know, about what's going on. I mean, just the bees. You watch the dandelions. You watch the three different kinds of ants I have in my yard. And I have the same kind of feeling, like I'm talking to them like, wow, you are much more important than I am. That kind of wonder about how that happens. It's the same with the fawn and the mummy deer. How does she know to teach him all that? How does she know how to have the baby? How does she know how to, you know, it all happens so beautifully. How does she know what to eat? It's all, and when you live in nature, like, you know, you're up on the hill from me and I'm here, and it's very important. I was teasing you the other day about dandelions, or I was teasing your mom about dandelions, because I come home in the springtime, in the summer, I go out in the backyard the next morning and I expect to see a lawn, you know, because I've talked to them before I leave. You know, I say, when I come back here, you dandelions. So, and then I give them a speech. I'm like the king, and they're like, and they're all shaking like this because they know, like, I'm a dandelion monster and I'm going to, like, you know. And so I say, you have 10 days. Get your canned goods, get your basketballs, get your hockey sticks, get on your motorcycles, and go to Saskatchewan, okay? And the only reason I let them have 10 days is because of your mother, Courtney. Because
the bees?
Bees. Mm-hmm. And the dandelions are very important for the bees, okay? Now, so what I learned from the dandelions is I tell them, you're not very good listeners because you don't seem to take any notice of what I say. And I say, all the time I try to teach myself to be a good listener. But I'll tell you what dandelions are. They're very determined. They will not give up. So I'll go out with my little, I don't know if you see my shovels and stuff in the back, and I will dig them up, and then I'll take them to your mother so she can make wine out of the stems, salad out of the leaves, and some kind of herbal tea that cures everything out of the petals, right? Mm-hmm. And I say, okay. And I say, we're fine now, you dandelions? Next day, no way. So, you know, what I learned from them is to follow my own advice to be a better listener, or somebody's going to dig me up. Or also to be determined. You know, if you have determination about good things, and they're very determined, those dandelions. But you could just go, whether you're Courtney lying down in the field and watch the ant, or you can just go out and talk to dandelions like a maniac, you know? And what does it teach you about life? Or like you said, you know, Jody, about your husband watching so many things in outer space and the nebulae, you know, and how he loves that kind of science on it. Or Courtney, the other day, just across the miner's path from where you are right now, when you go on the other side of the miner's path up the bridge, when you walk back down into town, there are enormous boulders, the size of this house sitting there. And the only way they got here is the ice age left them there. Mm-hmm. They're twice the size of this house. And you think, Kirk, 20th century, 21st century, male, human, oh yeah, really important. But let's take Jody's husband looking at outer space, or the ice age, or the ant, or the dandelion, or little red, and the worms. And that's what this small place puts me in touch with, that kind of wonder, whether it's macro or mini or ice cream with little red. And I'm very grateful that I'm here in this small place and that I come from this small place.
I feel like Jody and I have talked a lot about this, how we feel very grateful during this time in history that we do live in this sort of corner of the world where, COVID, it was a reality here as it was everywhere in the world, but to a certain extent, it was a moment of reconnection for many, many of us in this town, where it gave us that chance to either pause because you couldn't be working, or just pause in nature because you didn't have the chance to be going to the grocery store and running the errands and busying yourself with the other things, even if you, like, because Jody was still very busy with work, being that she is a teacher. I'm a substitute teacher, so I was out of work, so I was at home with Little Red. So totally two different scenarios for each of us, but both of us very intensely experiencing kind of that wonder, in the sense of wondering of more, like, what's more than what we are currently looking at? What's more than what we have currently been allowing ourselves to see? And when you open yourself up to that, it's amazing what shows itself to you. And I think that for those people, like, because I'm hoping that there's going to be people in Chicago as well who are going to be watching this video. And so I don't think it's isolated to just a small mountain town. I think we're very blessed to live here, but I'm hoping that everybody can glean from this conversation and just asking yourself, like, what can I wonder about? Like, what can I open myself up to? And what can I experience differently? Even like, what am I being called to experience differently? And especially now that things are starting to get back to like normal, I hope that normal is a new normal, in the sense that we are evolving beyond this instead of just returning back to the way things were. And your story is so such an example of that evolution, I think.
Well, I'm thinking, I think all of us will be, or hopefully, as you say, more grateful. We'll be more grateful. We'll not take our health for granted. We won't take music for granted, of being together, for me as a musician, with my colleagues, to being together with the patrons, think that just the normalcy of life. And also maybe to just be a little more empathetic. Mm-hmm. Like, I feel that inside myself. I feel that I don't know how to describe that. I just feel more forgiving, more patient, more willing to look at somebody's other side, or just wait a minute, think about things, listen, consider, golden rule thing, like that kind of thing. I can't quite describe that, how that's happening to me up here almost every day. And also it's because I'm not sitting in Kirkatraz, which is what they call my study prison, where I study all day and I'm not allowed out. And so I have my brain and my heart have a chance to look inside more, like you said, or to, I heard this story the other day, and I thought about it inside myself, whether I would be capable of something like this. And I don't think I am. I don't think I'm that big a person. But I have a friend here. I call him Uncle Marcel. He's not my uncle, but he's like my uncle. And I was talking to him social distancing the other day, and he grew up in Fort McLeod. And Courtney, his family is French Canadian, right? And they were all builders in construction. And my Uncle Marcel is just really tough. He can fix anything. He's worked for the town. He has a bear gun in his house that I can't even lift up, never mind go hunting with, And yet he told me this story that his French Canadian grandparents, who lived a few doors down from him, his grandmother died when she was quite young, and the grandfather was there by himself. And after a while, they were worried about grandpa, first of all, just being lonely all the time without his wife that he loved so very, very much. And he used to show Uncle Marcel the locket with his wife's picture in it and cry and talk about his wife, So the grandpa's by himself, and he was not doing very well health-wise. So Uncle Marcel, at 7 years old, decided that every night he would go over and sleep at grandpa's house. And he did 7 years until he was 14, every single night.
No and way.
If you met Uncle Marcel, he's not like, oh, let's read poetry and go to the ballet kind of stuff. He's a very man's man. He's a very nice man. But he's, you just think, wow, what did this little boy just thought of his grandfather so much? And then, me, I was tooling around on my bicycle when I was 11, probably causing trouble, after dark. But he was over at his grandpa's house. You think, wow. And I sort of looked inside myself when I left and I thought, who's that big? You know, mm-hmm. little, that I'm a grown man, you know? So mm-hmm. that empathy that empathy sort of rare. I remember the story of your wonderful sister who did that for a friend every morning, you know, getting up and just going to help a friend of hers every morning just to get ready for school. And
yeah, he had a physical disability and had to walk with a walker, and she helped him on the bus every morning. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so those of you that don't know Courtney's sister, all through, I think, junior high school and high school, just got up early in the morning and the freaking freezing cold, you know, and walked over to her friend's house and helped him because he had a physical disability to get ready for school, and then walked to the bus with them, and nobody told her to do it. No. That just, and you think, who is that kid? Who is that kid who has that gift? You know, because that's the gift of hers maybe, whereas it might not be my gift, you know, or anybody else who's listening. But yeah, we could all be more of those things every day. I'm trying to do it, Courtney and Jody, because I have a friend in Chicago, and she and her son are wonderful, 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 wonderful people. You'd love them here in the Crow's Nest Pass. And they spend a great deal of their time helping other people. Like, they find people who are 96 or 92 or somebody who can't do this, and they go and they spend a lot of their time and energy helping those people. And they're patrons at my concerts, and I get to know them. So they told me about this lady named Edith, who is in a home now that they used to go and visit every week, every 3 days, take things to her, bring her some flowers, bring her some chocolates, do stuff, bring her, you know, tell her, talk to her, and now she's in a home. Edith is 99 and a half. She's alone in a home. Nobody can visit her, and she's completely blind. So, what I have taken upon my little Kirk self is to every 2 days call Edith.
No way!
Yeah, I'll show you on my phone. You watch. And like tomorrow, I'm going to call her. It's Friday tomorrow. And I'm going to say, hi, Edith. It's Kirk, the conductor guy from Canada. And I'm telling you, this is sharp as a whip. And she's funny. And she's humble. And she's smart. And you think, I want, you know, this woman has had a full life. When she was 22, she was out dancing. When she was 31, she was taking care of her kids. When she was 42, she changed jobs. When she was 50, she went through a war. When she was 60, her husband got sick. Now she's 99 and a half, and she's completely blind. You know what? I'm going to do something good in the world. I can't be like Uncle Marcel. I can't be like Charlotte. But I'm going to do this little thing, and I put it on my calendar every 2 days, call Edith. And you know, I'm going to tell you something. If I were in Chicago right now, I probably wouldn't do it. So that pause that you're talking about, Courtney, and maybe I will more now in the future, that I'll look at this more beautiful part of who I could be and capture some of it and let it, you know, sort of resonate in me. I don't know if I will. Maybe I'll go back to study prison, back to Kirkatraz and conductor man, you know, I don't know. But anyway, I'm not sure why I told you that story.
I love that story. It's something that I hope for after this pandemic, you know, is done its thing, and we go back to whatever our regular life looks like, that people can take the lessons that they've learned during this slowdown time, this time where, you know, mountain bikes sold out in North America, in this time where our little local outdoor store Spry has been working, you know, to their bones because they're so busy. This time where people have realized through forced scenarios the importance of nature and the importance of being outside and the importance of slowing down and visiting people and talking to people and taking that time to do that, because it's so easy to be busy. It is really, really easy to be busy in this world. And it takes a conscious effort to not be busy sometimes.
I watched Courtney do that, actually. I watched Courtney, and not that I know, I'm not around Courtney very much, but I had this sense that even when Little Red was a baby, when she needs a lot of care, that Courtney would sort of carve out some times for herself to go running. Now, a lot of moms won't do that because either they're guilty or they feel, I'm not sure that I'm stating that correctly, Courtney, but just that we each say, do I have time to call Edith today instead of being a morning doctor all afternoon? Or do I have time, like I take a 2-hour walk every night. And I was walking the other night in Blairmore and I thought, I think this is my favorite thing to do in the whole world. It's so quiet. You see a deer, you see a dog, you see a person, it's nature, the water and the river smells unbelievable. The carrigana bushes, all of that stuff. It's such beauty, And I agree with what you say. And it worries me, you as teachers, I want to tell you, it worries me that a lot of my very talented and intelligent young assistants, for example, who work with me as my colleagues, they spend a lot of time doing this. Oh, by the way, the back of my phone is a map of the Crow's Nest Pass.
Of course it is.
That's awesome.
Yeah, see, there's all the towns. Okay, so, but it worries me that kind of small, quick thought doesn't ever lead you to reading the Iliad, to creating a stage play in your mind, to thinking what you're going to do for your mother's birthday in a month, to thinking about, whatever. Just remembering, one of my favorite things is that as I walk, I go by houses and I remember the voices of the people and their appearance and their idiosyncrasies,
so cool.
Car they used to drive and all that stuff. And these were wonderful. I'm sure they were normal people, but these were wonderful, honest, hardworking people. I mean, like your grandparents, the Kovaches, Courtney, or we were talking about your Vastenhut family. Oh, I'm sure the Vastenhuts were really, really rich. No, they came off the frickin' boat from Holland. They had wooden furniture. Like her great grandmother came on the boat not even knowing who she was gonna marry, right? Your Mark Holland, right? And then when she got to Halifax, they lost all of her possessions. She came on the train with just her purse and the clothes on her back. These are wonderful people. So as I walk by the Mark Holland house or the Kovach house or the Vassenhut house or whatever, I'm remembering these wonderful, humble people. And it's really important to me.
There's a book out there, I don't know if you've heard of it, called The Blue Zones.
No.
And the essence of this book, there's the author of it, I believe he worked for National Geographic. And part of his position there was doing some research around the world. I'm probably messing this up a little bit, but that's okay. It's okay if I screw it up a little bit. I believe where the passion started was starting to find places where people live to be centenarians, so 100 years, and studying what is it about their lifestyle there that allows them to live so long. So they looked at lifestyle. They looked at are there religious parts of their lifestyle, what's their diet like, how much exercise do they have, all of these different things. And then they once they had accumulated all that data and sort of processed it, they called these places the blue zones. And I don't remember specifically where they all are, some in Japan, there's one in the state, there's lots, doesn't matter. Anyways, one of the main things, nutrition was the number one thing, the food that they ate. But one of the right up there alongside with that was community. So the author was saying that in many of these blue zones, people spend 6 to 8 hours of their day communicating with people, and not necessarily in a busy work way. So you know, like sitting down and having a meal, like a 2-hour lunch break with people, or sitting at a cafe together and just communicating and having coffee, or going for a walk with people. And I see that happening, and I feel the life in people around me when that happens. And like, so even now we've got this community trail that connects our, like we've got five, six communities in our town, and there's a community trail that kind of connects them, and people can bike or run on them. And one thing that I noticed, a drastic shift since everybody had to be indoors, well, like, you know, isolated, was that I passed so many more people on the community trail, obviously 6 feet apart, but you know, like, but we wouldn't just walk past each other, which maybe would have happened in the past. We would stop and talk to each other because we really wanted that connection, because we were lacking in connection with people face to face. And so this was a place where we could connect, and that connection give, like, you know, that smile, the whatever that is, there was life that happened that feels different than the busy type of like, hi, oh, how you doing? Okay, bye, see you later, you know? And another thing, what was interesting too, what he said is, even talking about the phone, social media, the research shows, like in their research and their findings, that social media kept within about an hour, like 30 minutes to an hour, just over, every single day, is actually quite beneficial, because it does provide that same amount of that same style of connection, where you do get to reconnect with people and see their stories and learn about them. Beyond that, he said, then the life-giving part of that, beyond that amount of time, the life-giving part of social media starts to dwindle away. Really interesting, like that is like research now, that there's data on that in these places around the world, that they live longer, literally live longer. They're healthier people because they connect with other people and they're not stuck in their own bubble.
Well, I'm sure it's why all of us love going to Barcelona or to Northern Italy, if you actually get to know some of the people. Even the, one of those episodes of Everybody Loves Raymond, where they go to Italy and like Raymond starts talking to his mother and going for a walk, you know, and things like that. And Frank ends up being sweet and picking flowers. And, you know, because there they do just what you're talking about. You know, you crazy Canadian, American, whatever, you know, running around like crazy, spending all day on the freeway and being in such a rush. We want to sit down and we eat. And in the old days, you know, of course, still in Barcelona or place in Madrid, they just take the afternoon off and they go home. And then, you know, you go to a concert that starts at 9:30 at night in Madrid. So what? You know, it's like, it's great. It's beautiful. And we all feel that when we go to those countries. And I notice it a lot with me when I first come home here, that first of all, I admire people for being so polite, and I think I'm polite, but everybody actually drives the speed limit. No, I mean, you come to the 80 kilometer an hour thing, every car goes 80 kilometers. You come to the school, 50 kilometers, you're going, oh my, and I'm going 80 or 85 miles an hour. Well, I don't know what that is in kilometers, 120, 130, 140, you know, all the time. And just, and even in the grocery store, I'm standing there with my little cart, you know, and some lady is talking to the checkout lady. Oh yeah, Uncle Fred, he got a new dog yesterday and blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, when I come home, I'm like, I'm going to kill you all. You're making me crazy. And the driving also makes me crazy, because 50 kilometers an hour on a highway is about 25 miles an hour on a highway. And I just notice it. And now I don't even notice it. I love it that I was in Spry the other day. Ladies talking about her children, about their dog, about their cat. I'm sitting waiting to check out. It's like totally great. It's like wonderful. You know, that people, it's like music. It's about people. It's about people, you know, and our empathy. And we see the crises in our lives today. Maybe not here in the Crow's Nest Pass, but the crises that are going on in the world of empathy. If you're sick, do you care about another person being sick? If you knew about a virus, would you tell somebody about a virus? if people have to die, or, you know, or people have to lose their jobs? What would you do if it was your daughter? What would you do if it was your son? What would you do if it was your mom? Mm-hmm. You know? I don't know. It's a shame that we've lost so much of it, because I don't think our grandparents, I don't think, and the many of the people who went before us, I don't think they were like that. I do not think so. So I give you the wonderful task, teachers, to bring forth the next empathetic, generous, kind, thought-filled generation. You have a big responsibility. Me, I just got to wave my arms and bah, 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 you know, stuff.
You know, it's funny, like, I teach high school mathematics, and teaching teenagers, you see where, like, the pressure of the world starts to direct their thoughts and choices and decisions versus what they maybe actually are tapped into. There's not very many grade 12 students I teach who actually have that connection here, where they actually know where they're going after high school, because there's so much pressure put on them. And like, that's like the public school system's fault, right? It's the fault of the leaders within schools to make certain conversations not a priority, et cetera. There's only so many conversations that we can have in a math classroom, you know, in the space of trying to get through all the curriculum, that we get so bogged down by information that we forget to talk about connection and talking about that, like that just that inner relationship. It's all about the exterior stuff. It's all about the goals and the achievements and the expectations that other people have on these young kiddos who are, you know, making big adult decisions when they leave high school, that it's definitely a task that the education system needs to take on. I don't know if it's going to take it on or ready to take it on, but just changing the dialogue within schools so that kids can learn more about themselves and more about other people versus, you know, the list of outcomes in the curriculum, you know.
So Jody and Court, can you change the curricula to have a, I'll make something up. Can you have a civics class where people will debate things, where they're given a challenge, where they're given a crisis, where they're given a problem, and even have some person be the dark Darth Vader and somebody be the Obi and say, okay, take this position and fight for it, like, you know, or like convince me that your dark side is good, or your greedy side, or your selfish side is good, and then have the other team, or it doesn't matter, or here's a problem, what would you do? You have to fire somebody, and they just had, you know, their wife just had triplets, and they're the greatest guy in the world, or you find another solution in the company. I mean, just what we need is thinking people who are not just thinking with their heads, mm-hmm. but thinking with their hearts. You know, or a class where people could take a situation in history and say, okay, what would you do if you were Churchill in this moment? What would you do if you were Caesar in this moment? Would you cross the Rubicon? What would you do if you were Mark Antony in this moment? What would you do if you were Hamlet in this moment? And maybe you don't come to the same conclusion as those Roman leaders or that British prime minister or that Shakespearean character, but If young people have the chance to think, you know, I would like to think that people are basically decent and good. And if they have a chance to use those tools over and over and over and over and over, then I think we can expect a better generation. Because I don't think that my generation is a very good generation. And I actually am sorry to say, I don't think yours is either. When I look at what goes on in the world, and how crass people can be, and uncaring, and illogical, and just without a hug to another human being, or a real feeling of country, or something. I mean, we know they're guys from BC. Oh, what are those BC guys doing? They live 5 miles from here. They're very nice people. oh, those people from Calgary, oh, those city slickers. Oh, right, city slickers, you know? And it's like, oh, you're pink, or you're polka dots, or you're black, or you're Muslim or something. It's so crazy because, you know what? If your mom and dad are Muslim, you're probably going to be a Muslim. And if your mom and dad are Asian, you're probably going to have Asian features. And if your parents are from Ireland, you're going to be really, really pale with blue eyes. And so who cares? Mm-hmm. But, you know, we don't teach that stuff. We don't think about that stuff. We don't spend our time doing it. We go, how is Junior going to get to law school?
Well, I think that goes back to our previous conversation too, which is we have in the education system, and this is totally my opinion, and I welcome feedback, but I think that we've crammed so much in terms of the checklist of what you have to learn that there's not room for compassion anymore. There's not enough time in the school day, let alone to get through the curriculum, than to try to, on top of that, teach how you would use that curriculum, or like what you're saying, there's, you know, to put yourself into the emotional state of the people that you're learning about. That type of assignment is glorious, to be able to take the time to fully engage in it and to allow the students to really reap the benefits of it and really connect to that. There's just so little time because we have so much to cover. Like I was doing a little bit of research for a family member on homeschooling, and in the research, and this is Alberta curriculum, I don't know how it is around the world, and but I know probably across Canada it's quite similar. 1400 curricular objectives per year. 1400 things that a teacher has to, like, that's ludicrous in my mind. How do you create any form of real learning, first of all, like if you're just talking like education, real learning, but then any type of undertone of life skill, and then any type of undertone of emotional connection to other human beings, and then below that, like any type of undertone of emotional connection to yourself. Kids don't know who they are anymore. Well, that's not true. Many kids do, but many kids don't. And I think we're losing touch because we're so up here, we're so surface level right now, and it's all breadth, nothing is depth anymore. And so if you don't go deep, you don't even know how to connect to yourself.
Yeah.
Well, so then it's like, what's the point? So you make all money, you got a boat, you got a house, you got a cabin, you blah blah blah, you look really pretty, you got perfect teeth, your figure's just right, la la la, you know, and what's the point? What's the point? You know, and look at our world right now. When you look at, you know, a lot of what's going on in our world, it's a nightmare. And it's because in the end, those Shakespearean things of the most important things to people are money and power, if you read enough of the plays. And then, of course, the downfalls. But we don't seem to learn from the Bible or the plays. What's the point of it all? So you have a really great house and you got a really great car, and you have perfect teeth, and la la la, and you've got 20 presents for your kids under the tree at Christmas time. But what's the point? I can tell you for me, and I'm no angel of any kind. You know, I'm admonishing myself as much as I say about anything else. I'm very happy living in this little 900 square foot house, and Courtney's grandparents gave me this. And Fred Bradley gave me that. And Courtney, you actually gave me something in the other room that you don't remember you gave me. And the couch cost $5. And the spread used to be my grandma's. And, you know, maybe it's me. I don't need to live in the 100-story, you know, high-rise that I live in Chicago. Mm-hmm. I don't. And I think that actually most people, I don't think Little Red needs much more in a day than a nice worm family to discover a lullaby that I think as soon as she started telling me about the lullaby, I went, oh, you know what? Courtney's taught her that. And I told you that when I saw you in the garden the other day. I said, I think Little Red has learned that when somebody's upset, you sing, or you sing a lullaby and just stay quiet. Maybe you do that to her when she's upset or something. You sing a lullaby. So already you see little Red, who's just 3 years old, taking that. And then we took her for a pistachio green ice cream cone. And she was over the moon, right? So there's that human being. What more does she really need? Does she need the Mercedes Benz or the $2 billion house? I don't actually think she needs it. I think she has to make a ton of money to be happy. I don't. And our grandparents didn't have any of that. And, you know, and we were lucky. We're the beneficiaries of them working hard and us having opportunity and the world changing in some ways for the better. But to me, you know, when you look at Norwegian education or things like that, you go, oh, here's a totally evolving, or Swedish education. They're looking at education in a completely different way. And using your blue zone, I would guess in the future, if they don't freeze to death up there, that those people are going to live a long time. Hmm. You know, or at least live happily for a long time, or not be divorced seven times, or not, you know, have a STD, or, you know, that they'll be more full human beings, which is what our planet should be. We start talking about wonder. We're on this freaking spinning planet at 25. We don't fall off of it. I don't understand that. I don't know why we're spinning. I don't know why the sun rises in the east and goes to the west. I don't know why the bees know how to make honey. I don't know any of this. And we should be the same things on this planet. We shouldn't be cutting the rainforest down. We shouldn't be having plastics in our stupid plastics in our oceans. We shouldn't be polluting our world with our dumb highways and stuff. We should be those people who are thinking about those things and valuing those things. And by the way, music too. But we can't do it as long as all we are is just like little robotic, learn this stuff, get our exams done, go to college, make a bunch of money, look at the stock market. So you have a big job, you two, you know?
Well, and I think the opportunity is in the pockets of the day, right? Like, we don't have control over the curriculum. We don't have control over diploma exams. We don't have control over our timetable assignment that our principal gives us. But we do have control with how we, like, what made me think of this is when you were saying how Little Red knew to give the worm a lullaby because that's what Courtney does for her when she's upset, or that we just can role model in the pockets of our day. So when we have a student in our classroom who seemed a little out of sorts or doesn't quite see themselves, we notice like something a little bit off, you know, we ask, we have the conversation, we take the time to connect and learn about our students, and then model that compassion and that empathy when we have the opportunity to, versus brushing it off because I have to get to this next class or get this marking done or just taking that time. We don't necessarily have the time and space to create a whole class or a whole lesson or, you know, a whole group thing about it. But we can, in those little pockets, those little opportunities, we can just role model it. And I think that's what lots of good teachers are doing. And then if we could take those little bits and expand them, that would be fantastic. I'm actually really excited in the fall I get to teach leadership again. I haven't been full time for a while. I stayed home with my kids for like four years, and just kind of went back to work recently. So this will be my first year full time in the classroom again. So I get to teach some option classes instead of just all math. And I get the junior high leadership and the senior high leadership. And I was thinking about it over the last couple of days as to like how I want to tackle it, and just like based on this conversation kind of validates what I was thinking, was just actually starting with like self-leadership and like how do we lead others if we don't know how to lead ourselves, and like starting that class actually with just helping kids connect with who they are, connect with their past, connect with their history, and then connect with where they want to go in the future, and then where do they want to lead their school to? What do they want to create in their school? But they can't really do that if they're not connected with themselves. So I'm actually really excited for that opportunity to get to kind of play around in that classroom. I'll have a little
bit. That's a really daunting challenge to take that on. I'm just thinking, wow, somebody, you know, I'm sure there is some kind of guideline and things like that, but that's enormous a responsibility. It just gave me an idea. You don't need to, it's a rhetorical question. Would you ever be able to have that class with some of the parents there too? Mm-hmm. You know, on the other side, even they could be the kid, or they could be the adult, or they could be the policeman, or they could be the governor, or they could be the leader of the corporation, and the parent is, you know, that kind of thing. Because, like, you talked about pockets, and, you know, it's always about, you know, does your principal have the consciousness to do this? Does your vice principal, does the school board, like Paul Pachursky, me going over to the elementary school when he was the principal, and every morning, him deciding as a leader to have every kid go into the gym. What grades was it, Courtney? 1, 2, and 3?
He was 4, 5, and 6 at his last.
4, 5, 6. Okay, so a certain group of that school, they all go into the gym, and then from what I understood and the little bit that I witnessed, he would have a message every day about, not about learn your grades and get a motorcycle, right? But it was about the signs he would put up in the school about, were you kind to somebody today? Do you need kindness today? You know, did you help somebody today? Did you need help with something today? I think you did, just like me. And then they would all play.
Yeah, like, so.
Whole school play ukuleles. And part of that, grade sixes helped the little grade fours, right? And they all had different colors, and they sang. And I thought, okay, these kids are going to go into school, and they're going to be just fine. They're going to be fine because they started their day, but it's that leader who takes that, or it's you as the teacher who can find that pocket. Or, for instance, Courtney has made she's made many conscious decisions that I've watched in her life. But on Fridays, she has Freaky Friday every Friday, right? What do you call it?
No, Friday with Franklin.
That's it. I couldn't remember the name of the book. So she, you know, she has this podcast, and she has little Michaela with her, little Red, and they talk about something, right? And then you read the story, right? And then you have Freaky Friday Dance Festival in the
kitchen.
Then
we dance. Yeah.
We dance. So right away, that little girl is getting her mother talking about something. She's unconsciously and consciously absorbing that Courtney's talking about. Then she gets to, like, read a story. And each week or month, she'll read more and more words and blah, blah, blah. And it must be a really good book series because there's learning examples. And then you know what they do at the end? They dance. So can you imagine, and Courtney, don't listen to this. Can you imagine when little Red is 23 and she goes back and looks at those things, what it's going to do to her? She'll just cry all day. She'll just cry and cry and cry and say, look at what my mother decided to do. My mother made this up in her head. I don't know anybody else that does a sort of podcast, reads a little book about Freddie or somebody, and then they do a dance festival in the kitchen. I don't know anybody like that. But if teachers and superintendents and governors and mayors and police chiefs and all of us could do that, me maybe as a musician, those little pockets you talk about making more blue in the world, you know?
I think that's a perfect opportunity to round it back into motherhood, especially since so much the people who Jody and I typically attract are women, especially moms. And your mom did something really special for you. And I think it's on the wall right beside, I don't know, is that one of those things? No, maybe not.
One of the letters from my mom?
Yeah, don't you have one? Your mom did several things. The thing that I'm thinking of, though, is the letters that she wrote you. And like when you're saying that Michaela, when she's 23 and can look back on those videos, it's profound to me that, I think they called you 40-ish in the newspaper article, that a 40-ish year old was so profoundly affected by his mom, and you hold your mom in reverence. And
I do.
Talk about that. Tell us about it. Yeah.
So here's a couple of the letters that my mom wrote to me, and I had them framed. Donna framed them for me, and I put them up on the wall to just remember. Just part, I mean, I have the stuff in here is of my dad, you know, working on, because he worked the shovel up on the coal mine. My in the kitchen, it's my mom and my pictures that I used to give to her, because I used to draw her a picture every day, and she would tell me it was the most beautiful, and I would pick dandelions and crocuses for her, and then she'd get down on her knee right there and say, oh, they're the most beautiful flowers in the whole world, and she put them in a little teacup. And I mean, all of these things for each one of us is very, you know, very vivid. But my mom was for sure, and if we're talking about motherhood, this is apropos. My mom for sure was the most important person ever in my life, ever. And she taught me so much. And I was a really stupid kid, and I was a bad kid, and I was a very immature kid. And only when I got to be about 25 or something like that, did just a single little ding go off in my head, like, oh, you know, first of all, I'm male, so I'm a moron, okay? Second of all, I happen to be a very immature male and very, oh, the old people and mothers and everybody, they're just dumb, they don't get it, you know? And now I see her, she talks in my ear, I'm actually this year, she talks in my ear all the time, like your mom, Courtney, we went to do some videos a couple weeks ago,
yeah.
And I'm driving, and I go over to the side of the car to open her door. And she's like, what are you doing? And I said, I'm opening your door. And she's like, oh, thank you. You know, like, and I can't not do that. Okay. I was walking on the street. I was just walking like 3 feet apart from somebody that I sort of knew. And we're walking. And I said, would you mind if I walk on the outside of the street? Because I really feel uncomfortable walking on the inside when a lady is walking. Now, if she doesn't, because maybe she feels it's, you know, like I'm being sexist or something, then fine, I don't care. But it's just, I hear her in my ear. Or like, or when Belle, your grandma, you know, comes into a room and I stand up, she always laughs at me like, oh, because my mother told me when a lady walks in the room, you stand up. I'm just, it's sort of like a nice, I don't know, a way to, like you hold your wife's hand. Or you do something sweet for her, or, you know, it's something just to care for a woman, not in a weak way, you know, or anything like that. You just care for a woman.
And well, it's a reverence, kind of, like you hold a person in reverence. Yeah,
exactly. So you think of her heart and that she's a woman, men and women are different, and then you just hold her in a special way, like when you make a vow in the old fashioned way. It's like you would make to protect her and care for her and whatever. I mean, women are just as capable of flying fighter jets and fighting wars and doing everything as men. But here's one. I'm probably going to cry. So, okay, I'll try not to cry. I'll be a good actor, okay? My mother wrote to me Christmas time. Music is a part of something larger. A musician is also a man. His attitude toward life is greater than his music. The two cannot be separated. A musician must not live in an ivory tower. He must love justice, reverence nature. He must revere life itself. He must work to change himself for the better. Oh, that he must be sincere at all times about love. He must strive to be a complete human being. And she had given me a little pocket watch. She says, please think about these things when you look at this watch.
Wow.
I look at it before I go to bed. It's right there on the wall. And, you know, she used to talk to me about those things all the time. And it did eventually, to some point, get inside me.
That's beautiful. I think that's where we close this off.
Okay. Thank you both.
Jode, any last words? Any last thoughts?
First, I just want to say thank you for sharing that. That's obviously a very special piece of your history and your relationship and your love and reverence and you know, for your mom. So I appreciate that you shared that with us and whoever is going to listen to this. I was listening to you read that and I was like, oh, I wish Kirk's mom wrote a book. I'm like, just in those few sentences, I was like, she was brilliant. The advice she gave you clearly had a profound impact. There's a question. I really do want to ask that question, Courtney, because
I'm
so incredibly curious as to what Kirk's response will be to it. I listened to a podcast. It's about an hour-ish long podcast on a run. I don't know. It was maybe 4 weeks ago or so. And I actually stopped in the middle of my run to text Courtney, which I often do because that's when my brain is clearest, is when I'm running and I'm like, oh, I got these ideas. And I can't use the voice to text thing while I'm running because it messes it up and Courtney doesn't know what I'm trying to say. So I'll stop and I'll text her what I'm thinking or feeling. And I sent her the link to the podcast because it was just brilliant. And it was about this physicist, a famous physicist. I've got his name written down somewhere, Richard Feynman. And he was also a teacher at a university. And he wanted to shift the science world through his teaching. He wanted to change the way students looked at science in university because it was just very regimented and like not very exciting. It was just learn the things. And students weren't taking science because of that. And he wanted to shift that. So he started teaching his undergrad classes by asking his students this question. And it's a brilliant question. And in this podcast, what they did is they interviewed all these different people and asked them all the same question. And they all gave answers that were so different and so incredible. And there was actually a musician that they had asked that actually composed a piece of music as their answer to the question, which I thought was really brilliant and creative. But the question is, if in some cataclysm, all of scientific knowledge is to be destroyed, everything we know today and have evidence of today is destroyed, and only one sentence was passed on to the next generation of creatures, which could be human or not human, what statement would contain the most information with the fewest words? And so he, as a physicist, he had his own like very sciencey answer, right, about atoms and blah, 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 blah. But in this podcast, they kind of took the science out of it. And they just said, if you were to give one piece of advice in one sentence with the fewest number of words, what would you give? What would you say? What would be your sentence? And so I ask you, Kirk, what would be your sentence?
Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Golden rule. Then there's no problems in the world. We'd all be goodnesses to each other, and we'd all take care of the ants and the worms and the birds and the fawns and the oceans, and we'd be grateful for the sky, and we'd be great to our children, and we'd be good to our spouses and our parents. And yeah, that's, if we just do that every day, I mean, if you put me in charge, I'd put a chip in everybody's head right now. And I know that's really bad and draconian, but it doesn't mean you couldn't lose your temper once in a while or tell your husband or you get upset with the trombones in rehearsal or something. Yeah, maybe okay. But generally, how would you want to be treated and hoping that everybody has at least a decent heart, you know? Then we're okay.
It's the first commandment, right? That's Bronwyn said the same thing in the last podcast.
Yeah. Oh, she did.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. Not to that question, but she brought it up as like love others the way love your neighbor as you love yourself. Same thing.
Right.
It's interesting to hear that repeated again.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Well, good. Maybe two people are thinking the same kind of thing.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you so much for your time. We so appreciate it and have such a, I think Courtney and I both, and we have this admiration for you and the way you live your life and what you do within your realm of the world to bring people a little bit more in community and in connection and in touch with themselves. So we appreciate you giving our little podcast your time. We're very grateful. And we ask that our listeners, if you feel like this was something that touched you, share this. Head over to Kirk's Facebook page, YouTube. Head over to his website. He's got all these cute little videos about the Courageous Pass out right now that are super fun to watch. And then just go on with your day, taking a moment to do what Kirk said, treat others as you would want to be treated. Just for a moment every day, think about that.
Okay. Thank you. I liked a lot just being with you, and it was a pleasure to be here with you. Give your wonderful husbands a big hug from me, okay?
Will do.
Bye.
Yeah, for sure. Thank you so much. Okay, until next time, guys.
Yeah, until next time.